Amen. All right, let's get settled in now. I ask you to please not be distracted in any way. Just listen right up to preaching. Attention up here. And a blessing to have Brother Abasi come. Come on, brother.
Alrighty, well, it is so good to be here tonight, and good to see all of you here. Thank you, ladies, for the delicious meal that you cooked. I saw my grandsons loading up on the deviled eggs. Amen. I'm sorry, the angel eggs, alright? And I saw Lucas. It was the first thing that he took a bite off on his plate. I've often wondered, you know, I ought to do a study, one of these. What does it mean? The first thing that you stab on your plate, take a bite of. I wonder what it means. It has to mean something. Amen. I got an idea of what it means. But it was just very good. Everything was just delicious. Thank you so much. Appreciate the chance to fellowship. And boy, we got to do some fishing today. I learned a new game today. I might go buy one of those things. Amen. And just practice on my fishing. Amen. One thing about us, as Baptists, we like to fish with the hook and the book. Amen? And that was a lot of fun. I appreciate that so very, very much. And I thank the preacher for the invitation to come and spend the day with you. We've enjoyed ourselves. Enjoyed the fireworks last night. That just really was really a nice show. I felt like it was like a fireworks 365. Amen? There's fireworks going all around us. Amen? And, my family knows I love to shoot off fireworks, amen. Now, in West Virginia, we can only buy them in the state where they just, nothing leaves the ground. But I like things that go up in the sky and pop loud, amen. I mean, that's what I like. So I have to cross the river into Ohio and buy me some good fireworks and sneak back into West Virginia. And but we sure appreciate it so very much. Thank you for the comfortable room. And just been a real delight. And appreciate the pastor mentioning those things about the armor. We would love to send it to you. It's all free of charge. Kind of gives you an idea of what's taking place in our ministry. And then also kind of keeps you abreast of the radio station. You know, radio is a very amazing ministry. Once again, it's nothing that we lean on, but it's a tool to use to get the gospel out. And 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, we get to declare the gospel of Jesus Christ. And what's fascinating about it today is because of the ability to stream, it goes all over the world. And the last statistics that I took of our station, I think we had 122 of the 195 countries of the world. I think that's what there is. 122 countries logged on to the website, the station website, to some degree. So who'd ever thought that a tiny little station in West Union, West Virginia, our town is a little over 800 people. Our county is not even 9,000 people. Our county is a small county and a small town, our county seat, West Union. But the gospel goes out. And the true message of salvation and good discipleship, a good, solid Christian radio station is a pastor's best friend, because it helps his people to be spiritually minded, helps them to keep their mind on the God and on the Bible and good Bible teaching and preaching. And really, it's amazing. I started my radio ministry way back in 1996, and just felt that it was just wanted to do something more for the Lord, just reach out to do my part to be a part of mass evangelism, reaching the multitudes through media, through radio. So I did it at a station in Dallas, Texas. And lo and behold, I didn't realize it, but that would put me, just having a broadcast, would put me in the loop with radio people. And then 10 years ago, we started the station. Back in 2008 is when we got our construction permit. It took us 3 years to build it. And then on the end of July, 10 years ago, we went on the air, and it was pretty amazing. We had, of course, our opening day, and we weren't on the air yet. We were having a celebration, but we weren't on the air yet. That's kind of hard to celebrate when you're not on the air yet. And right in the middle of the celebration, the stream made the connection from the studio to the transmitter link, and it was right at about noontime. And every day we play the national anthem at noon. So the first song played on the radio station over the airwaves was the national anthem, the Star Spangled Banner. Now listen, you just can't make things like that happen. They just happen that way. And the local people have given to keep the station going. There's a lot of technical things. I mean, you're dealing with the Federal Communication Commission. I mean, you're dealing with the federal government. You know the red tape and all the stuff that goes along with that. But it's worth it, amen, because we're getting out the gospel. And pray for us. Right now, we're a part of an initiative. We're trying to get the gospel and get stations in rural parts of America. So there may be some opportunities for us to expand the radio station. I'm always looking for ways to do that, and not just WDGV, but to help other people start radio stations. So keep us in prayer about that. And then at least try to download the station, the app on your phone. It's real simple to do. If you have a modern cell phone, you used to have to download an app that would read these little codes here. But if you've got a pretty new phone, all you do is open up your camera and just put it right there on that little box. If you have an iPhone, it'll go right straight to the iStore and it'll pop up. It's a brand new app, and it's green and black. And just say yes, you want to download it. And you download right to your phone. Doesn't cost any money. We made it all free of charge. If you have an Android phone, then that's the code that you use. Once again, put your camera right on that little square right there, and it takes you right straight to the site. And you can download the app, and you can listen to it. And we put together some good. We got a good genre of music. We've got everything from bluegrass, gospel style music, to sacred hymns. We have a wide variety of music. Some southern style gospel music, just some traditional church music. We've got men's quartets. We've got youth singers at, I think it's at 5 o'clock every Monday through Friday. We have youth and youth choir singing, and just a real neat time to listen to some music. We've got news programs that will just keep you abreast and keep you informed on the Christian side of the news. At 7 o'clock in the morning, Brother Tom Williams with Fortress of Faith, and he keeps us abreast on Islam and what's going on and their tactics. And then at noontime, Stand in the Gap Today, what is happening tomorrow, they're going to talk about it the next day and give you the Christian perspective of it. Then at 3 o'clock, we air a Christian call-in talk show called Crosstalk. And I promise you, you're not going to get the news. I mean, I'm familiar with all the conservative stations, news outlets. Some people consider Fox News to be a conservative news station. Then there's Real America and Newsmax and One America News and right-wing news broadcasting. But I promise you, you're not getting all the news. You're not getting the Christian perspective of it. All of those news services, the news is filtered. You're only going to get what they want you to know. And there's always, many times, there's going to be a slant to it. So you've got to get your news at other places to really know what's taking place, because we're just living at a very unusual time. So we love the radio ministry. It's just a great outreach. And we thank the Lord for it. So I hope that you'll try to find us. If you don't even have a phone that does an app, I even have a phone number that you can dial. And you can, this number, where you can dial that number and you can pick up the stream free of charge. So you can do it on, it doesn't have to be a cell phone. It can be a house phone or speaker phone at home or whatever. So we've tried to get every way possible to get people to find a way for them to listen to some good radio, good music, and good Bible preaching. And we just really thank the Lord for it. I just love the radio ministry, the radio outreach. And just kind of hard to believe that we've been doing it now for 10 years. I know I keep saying that, but Man, it's just, it's been amazing. It's a lot of hard work to it, amen. Last couple of weeks, both of our stations have gone down, and we have just been up on the top of the hills, working on things. Listen, I am a Baptist preacher. I didn't go to school for radio engineering. That's way, way beyond me. I know more about it than I ever wanted to know. Amen? But sometimes you just have to just dive in and get it done. And thank the Lord. I think that we're pretty much, we have a surge protector up on the hilltop of our main station. And it is it protects all of our equipment up to 100,000 volts. Is a lightning strike. We had a lightning strike take out a transmitter back, you know, we were just started. And that surge protector, both fuses were blown. So we had some kind of severe, you know, those storms a couple of weeks ago that just were coming through, fast moving, hard storms? Well, it took us out, man. But thank the Lord, I called a preacher friend of mine. I wasn't about to open up that box. I didn't know what was in that box. It was two little fuses. And I tell you what, I just don't like that. I've been shot too many times. And he didn't even worry about it. He got a pair of needle nose pliers and just stuck them in there and pulling things out. I'm just waiting for sparks. Thank the Lord we got them back in, and we're broadcasting and all of those good things there. So, amen. We thank the Lord for it. Thank you, preacher, for inviting me to come today. We really enjoyed it. I'm glad to see these young people. I know I got all these boys over there, but I tell you, boys, I love you. I know I look at you guys and I see so much potential. How old are you on the back row? How old are you, son? 15 years old. Do you know that when I was 15, I started traveling with an evangelist by the name of Joe Boyd. I was your age. And I started traveling. That just seemed so young. I said goodbye to my mom and dad for the summertime and started traveling and preaching and having training in evangelism. So your teenage years, your young years, they mean something. I know that maybe you might not, you know, you might have some struggles in your life. But I'm telling you, there comes a point in time in your life when you realize choices that I make about reading my Bible, about prayer, about taking God serious, there just comes a time in your life when all of a sudden it becomes real to you. And you just make a change. And you don't even understand, you boys, you little ladies, my grandsons, you don't even understand what God can do with your life if you'll just surrender to Him and you'll just give it all to Him. You can't even imagine what God will do. Now the devil, he wants you to get involved in drugs and everything, mean and ugly, and destroy your life. But God, He will do. Listen, I just came from such a simple home. I started riding a Sunday school bus to church when I was 9 years old. And I had preached the gospel around the world. And I just came from such a simple, simple home. And you know why? It wasn't because of Oliver. It was because of God. And I gave my life to God. And God has done all this in my life. Amen. I can't hardly believe it, to be honest with you. Amen. And God doesn't love me more than He loves you. He loves you. He loves you unconditionally. He loves you. And if you will give your life to Him, and you will start reading your Bible, and you'll start praying, and you'll start trying to do the things with God's help, you just can't imagine what God can do in your life. So when I get on to you, it's because what I'm saying is important. And you got to listen to it. And then also because other people might not be able to pay attention. Now, I appreciate these boys. Both of them came and shook my hand this morning. Shaked. Can you imagine? I was going to say shake my hand. These boys came and shook my hand this morning. They looked me right in the eyeball. Doesn't that say a lot about these boys? A lot of boys, boy, they would hate me. They wouldn't even come back tonight because I got on to them. But here they are. They're here sitting in church tonight looking at me. That says a lot about those boys, doesn't it? Amen. It really does. Well, if you have your Bibles, I want you to look with me to Ephesians chapter number 2. feel like this is where we go to tonight, Ephesians chapter number 2, and I want to begin reading with verse number 7, Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 7. Let's stand together. If you're able to stand with me, let's all stand together for the reading of God's Word. Amen. And if you get a little bit tired, you'll get out nice and good and woke up. Amen. You won't be a part of the woke movement. You'll just get woke up. All right?
Amen.
That Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 7. Notice what it says. That in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Now verse 10 is my text verse. Now look at it. It says this, for we are his, what's that next word?
Workmanship.
So it means to me, it kind of is telling us right off the bat there that God's doing something in us. Amen. We are his workmanship. Amen. We are his. It's a personal thing. Created in Christ Jesus, what's the next word? Unto good works. I want you to notice those words there, good works, which God hath before ordained, that means to fit up in advance, that we should walk in them. I want to preach a message tonight that I've just simply entitled right from the scriptures, We Are His Workmanship. We are his workmanship. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Father, we come now in the precious name of Jesus, and we ask that you'll give us help from heaven, Father. Vain is the help of men. Thank you for being so good to us, so wonderful, so loving and kind and generous. Lord, you're a good God. You're a kind God. You're a loving God. You're a merciful God. And we thank you, Lord, for that. Thank you, dear God, that you even thought about church and created it. Now that I've been saved and baptized, Lord, I'm a member of a good Bible-preaching church, just like this one here. What a wonderful thing to be a part of a church. People that love you and care about you and point you in the right direction. So we pray you'll bless this church service. I'm grateful to be here. Bless our time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go ahead and be seated. Thank you so much for standing with me. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but I'm going to kind of give you some thoughts that I wrote down, starting with verse number 1, kind of just to kind of give you the context of the passage here from the book of Ephesians. Verse number 1 talks about the quickening. The Bible says we're being quickening from being dead in our sins. Verse number 2 talks about the course of the dead that we all walked in. Verse number 3 talks about the conversation that we had in time past. That means our past lifestyle. Verse number 4 is the conjunction. Amen. You remember when I was growing up, they had a television commercial that was helping to teach the parts of speech, and it just got lodged in my brain, but I remember it went like this. Conjunction, junction, watch your function, joining words and phrases and clauses. Amen. Well, that word there, but God, it's joining everything before and after, but God, who is rich in mercy. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank God for the conjunction. And then in verse 5, the Christ. The Bible says it quickened us together. We're quickened together with Christ. Verse number 6 is the chair. Amen. The Bible says we're seated in heavenly places. It's our position. You see, God is so awesome and so amazing that he sees us in our position. Those of us that have been born again, we are seated with Christ even in the heavenlies. It's like we're already there. Amen. Because God is sovereign and he is so wonderful. And then in verse number 7, we have the coming ages. Amen. And verse number 8 and 9, the conversion. Amen. And then verse number 10, the craftsmanship. And that's where I want to spend a little bit of time on this morning, or this evening. The Bible says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. I'm telling you, it is such a blessing to be saved. Amen. To be redeemed. But then to just think about it. The Bible says we are His workmanship. Amen. Now I have had dentists work on me, on my teeth. Amen. I fell last November. I got home from some meetings in South Georgia. And I got home, and on the 9th of November last year, I slipped on wet grass. My right leg went out. My left leg pinned behind me, bent at the knee, and it severed that quadricep tendon. Just popped it just right off. And I knew it was hurt. And my wife knew I was hurt when I said, honey, you're going to have to take me to the doctor. She looked at me like, what? You ain't never asked me to do that before. I mean, she knew I was hurt when I said, you're going to have to take me to the doctor. Amen. And I'm telling you, that doctor, really, I'm thankful for it because he put it back together. I would have never been able. You can see me kind of walking slow because when I stand a while, man, that knee just gets stiff. But he put it back together. Amen. I mean, that doctor really worked on me. Amen. He worked on me. He put my knee, those muscles and that tendon back together and sewed it up. And there's a place where you can see the end of the stitches. I'll raise up my pant leg if you want to see it tonight after church and show you the big old long scar. But anyway, I mean, he's working. Well, listen, the dentists and the doctors haven't been the only one that's been working on me. God has been working on me. Amen. For we are His workmanship. Just think about God working on me. I want you to get the picture of this. We are a manufactured product. Amen. Of His saving, redeeming power. Something that He is making. Something that He is producing in us by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. Amen. What an amazing thing. We are His workmanship. God is working on you. You precious young ladies right here. And these older ladies right over here. And these young men. And all about here. Everybody here. Amen. We are His workmanship. He's doing something in us and through us by the power of God. Amen. It's the same idea that we get from the verse that I find in Romans chapter 1, verse 20, which says this, being understood by the things that are made, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead. Amen. Only God can do something with wretched sinners like we are. Amen. Now I want us to break down this verse here, look at some key words, and we're going to put some definitions to them and try to make some applications. So the Bible says we are. So it's not just talking about every single person in the whole wide world. We know that God loves everybody, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. But right here, He is talking about the redeemed of God. We are. That's talking about the redeemed of God, the blood-washed throne. Amen. We are. No doubt whatsoever, it's talking about the people that are saved. Amen. We are His. And that's a capital H. I'm talking about we are His. In other words, it's a reference to the all-sufficient, self-sustaining, omnipotent God that had the power to speak the world into existence. Can you imagine somebody so powerful? Look at me now. So powerful that God said, let there be light. And He spoke light into existence. Remember, He didn't even make the sun and stars till later on in the days of creation. God said, let there be light. And there was light. How amazing is that? Amen. He's the one that made us. The human body is so complex. The ear structure, the human eye, the brain, all of the organs, all of the veins and the arteries that go through our bodies and all the functions, the motor skills and all of that. It's just a miraculous thing. And then the instincts that He puts in animals. They don't reason things out. They respond the way they do by their instincts. It is put in them by God. We, as God's creatures, we're the only ones that reason things out. Amen? I've seen deer at the edge of the road. I've seen squirrels and deer and other animals at the edge of the road, and here comes the car. Now, if it's a person, they're looking at that car, and they're looking at the road on the other side, and they're thinking, is it safe for me to cross? Is it safe for me to cross?
But an animal, they can't think like that. That's why when they get up front, they run right in front of you. Pow! You got to take your car to the automotive place and get it fixed up. They can't reason things out. You see, God made us in a very unique way. We are created in His image. Body, soul, and spirit. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. And every one of you, you're not like just an animal. You are created in the image of God. You have a body, you got a soul, and you got a spirit. And when you get born again, that spirit is made alive and you communicate with God. The same God that spoke the world into existence. Amen. We are His workmanship. In other words, we're a product made by His redeeming grace, by His power, His workmanship, created. That means crafted with the idea of proprietorship of the manufacturer, created. Amen. In other words, we're God made. Amen. God saved, God made. Now every one of us, unless it's a homemade garment, there's some kind of a tag on your clothes somewhere that says where that garment was made. Hopefully it says made in the USA. Amen. Made in America. It might say made in Mexico, or made in Canada, or made in Taiwan, or made in Japan. Hopefully it doesn't say made in China. Amen. I don't have anything against Chinese people, but I do not care for the Chinese government. Amen. I love the Chinese people. But anyway, the point is made. We're created in Christ Jesus unto good works. That word good means beneficial. Too many people, they spend their lifetime in works that are not good. Instead of trying to help the church and build the church and move the church forward with good works, they try to hinder. The church wants to buy a bus and they gripe. The church wants to have a youth activity and take it him and they gripe. The church wants to spend some money and buy some song books or tracts and they gripe. Man, listen, don't be about bad works, be about good works. Amen. Then if you get quiet, it's going to be 30 minutes longer on the same point. But you got to say amen, even if it hurts. Come on now. Help me now. Amen. Good works. The Bible talks about ordained. Amen. That means to fit up in advance. Amen. The Bible says that we are ordained to walk in. And that walk means as a proof of ability, walking the course of life. In other words, these good works, they are supposed to come out of those of us who are believers, because we've been saved. These good works don't come, they don't produce any kind of grace. They don't produce any kind of salvation. Amen? If you're trusting your works to go to heaven, you'll bust hell wide open. But now that you've been born again, these good works are to come out of that relationship with Jesus Christ. Now praise God for salvation in Jesus. And praise God for eternal salvation through the Jesus Christ and through the blood of Jesus. As a matter of fact, there's no other way that Jesus can save us but to save us eternally. Amen? There's no other way. How in the world can God save us any other way but to be saved eternally? Amen? Eternal salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ. We can thank God for that. And praise God that we're saved by grace through faith in the death and burial and resurrection, glorious resurrection of Jesus Christ. But now that I'm saved, the Bible says I'm supposed to be producing good works. Something that comes out of my life that is beneficial to other people. I want you to notice, you don't have to turn here, but we'll look at the verses. But in Acts chapter 10, verse 38, it says this. It says this, God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. You see, God, the Lord Jesus, was the world's greatest philanthropist. Amen. I mean, he went about doing good. I mean, he is the true example of divine benevolence toward the entire human family. Amen. Universal goodwill. God loves everybody. God wants everybody to be saved. Amen. God is not willing that any should perish. It's not His will that any person perish. Now it's sad, but some people will not repent. They will not believe. But it's God's will for everybody to believe and be saved. But listen, it's not going to happen until you hear the gospel and respond to it. Amen? Oh, thank God for that. So we know that Jesus set the example, amen, of doing good, and we are to follow His example. Amen. Oh, the Bible talks about that we are His workmanship. It says, in all things, showing thyself a pattern of good works, in doctrine, showing uncorruptness, gravity, sincerity, sound speech, they cannot be condemned. That he that is of the contrary part may be ashamed, having no evil thing to say of you. So these good works are a pattern, amen, that shows people about the goodness of God. So I think tonight we can thank God. We can thank God for salvation. And we can thank God that we are His workmanship. And God, to every one of us that are redeemed tonight, He is creating in us. There's not one single person that this is not happening with, that God is leaving behind. This is everybody that's here. Amen. Amen. We're His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. And what is He doing? He is creating in us good works that He has already prepared us to walk in. Amen. And the Holy Scriptures explains to us that these deeds, so what they are, so we have no question and we can rejoice in them. Now I want you to take your Bibles and look with me to 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse number 12. Now while you're turning to 1 Peter chapter 2 verse number 12, I'm going to quote a Bible verse to you while you're looking at that verse. Amen. Go ahead and look at that verse there. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 12. And then while you're turning there, I'm going to quote another verse to you. Matthew 5 and verse 16. Here's what you're looking at that verse. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works. You hear that? Your good works, and glorify your Father which is in heaven. So we're talking about good works. Now with that verse in mind, I'm going to read to you 1 Peter chapter 2, 12. Having your conversation honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. Did you see that? That they may by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. So let's be clear. Your light is your testimony of salvation before men. Amen? And what shines is the good works. And these good works are to glorify God. Amen? And according to 1 Peter chapter 2, 12, your conversation, your lifestyle, people are watching it. And one day, God's going to visit them. He's going to visit them with conviction. He's going to visit them with a gospel presentation. And they're going to remember your good works. And your good works are going to be powerful in their lives for the gospel's sake, for the power of the gospel. Watching your good works will boast how they see the power of God when He visits them through conviction. Amen. So the truth is simply this. Somebody has their eye on you. Amen. Because of that, we ought to be producing good works that glorify God. Amen. These good works, they don't boast Oliver, Areza. They don't boast you. They're not for these good works that we're supposed to be about. They're not so that we'd be up here looking like King Tut or somebody big shot. Amen. These good works are for the sole purpose of bringing glory and honor to God. Amen. So when the Holy Ghost of God visits them, it's a powerful witness. Amen. If I understand what the Bible says. Amen. I'm thinking about a young man right now. I know him well, know his family well. He was going to a Bible college. And they had some real serious problems up in that college while he was going there. He came home to visit his dad between the Christmas and New Year's break. And he had a lot of confidence in these people. And they broke his confidence. And because he had such confidence in these men, it kind of shattered his confidence and his trust in God. It happens sometimes because we look to people, we just elevate them so high, they mean so much to us. When something wrong happens, it just devastates us. And that's what happened. And this young man, this young preacher boy, was that close to throwing in the towel and giving up, saying, I don't want to be in the ministry. I don't want to preach. I don't want to do anything. I don't even want to go to church. I just want to get out and just live just a normal life like everybody else. Just walk away from everything. And his dad was a pastor of a church. And his dad was saying, son, you've been hurt. Your trust has been broken in these people. And you can't see things clearly. You don't ever make an important life-changing decision when you're in this condition. You got to let things settle. Just give God a chance. Don't quit. And he said to his dad, I think most people are fakes. I think, listen, if they would never really do things for themselves, I think people are mostly fakes and phonies. He said, Dad, I think you're real. And I think Mom's real. But I think about most everybody else, they're just not real. They're just doing it maybe to be seen or because they have to. They really don't have any personal initiative to do it. He said, son, you've just been hurt. You just don't understand. And then all of a sudden, his dad looked over toward the buses. Remember, it was in between Christmas and New Year's. And it was cold. And where they lived, the snow was flying and the temperatures had plummeted. It was cold. And the preacher noticed some movement over by the buses. They had a bunch of Sunday school buses that they ran. And he pulled open the shades in his office, the curtains, and he saw one of the elder servants in the church, an older man. And he was running some extension cord from the fellowship over to the buses, the Sunday school buses. And he was plugging up those engine warmers for those diesels so they'll start up the next morning because it was so cold. And he was out there all by himself. Nobody asked him to do it. Nobody else was helping him. He was over 80 years old, and he was out there running those cords and plugging those wires into those buses there so that the buses would start. And the bus drivers and bus captains could go pick up the boys and girls for church so they could hear about Jesus and hear about the power of God and sing Christian songs and have a wonderful time and bring a little bit of heaven into their home. Nobody told him to do it. And that preacher saw him out there, and he pulled the curtains back, and he called his son over from the window, and he called his name, and he said, Do you think it's real to him? And that preacher's son saw that old dear saint out there in the cold doing that. Nobody told him to do it. I don't know if that young man, that dear old saint ever really knew what his testimony, what his good works did that night. But I'm telling you, it spared that young man. Now, he worked for his dad now. He's a fine preacher. I've heard him preach. His wife, they had a baby. The first baby they had died. It was very sad for him. But God's given him another little girl and another little boy. He's a fine young preacher, solid young preacher, just solid, solid as can be. And I don't really know if he would be where he was without the good work of that dear saint on that cold, cold January night, running those cords out. That they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. You see, these good works that were all ordained, they always bring glory to God. I'm telling you, just ask the Lord, what do you want me to do? And God will show you some good works to do to your mom and dad, to do to your parents, your grandparents, to do to your relatives, the other people in your house. And when you do those good works, God's going to get the glory in them. And when God visits them, they're going to know something happened to my daughter. Something happened to my son. Something happened to them. Look at these good works that they're doing. And it means something. And what does that verse mean then? Having your conversation. That's talking about your lifestyle honest among the Gentiles. That whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. I want you to see number two, these good works. Well, look at Titus chapter 3, verse 8. Titus chapter number 3 and verse number 8. You find that verse there. Titus chapter number 3 and verse 8. And once you found it, I want somebody to say amen.
Amen.
All right, man. We had like a sword drill. Preacher found that thing fast, didn't he? Now, the Bible says this. Listen to it. This is a faithful saying. And these things I will that thou affirm constantly. In other words, you better pay attention to them all the time. That they which have believed in God. How many of you have believed in God for salvation? Hold up your hind leg. I mean, hold up your hands. Amen. All right, good. Believed in God might be careful to maintain, what's the next words? Good works, which these things are good and profitable unto men. So the second thing about these good works, number one, they bring glory to God. They don't ever, it's not for us to receive glory. God gets the glory. But the second thing about it is these good works that we're all ordained to walk in, these good deeds, they touch people's lives. Amen? They touch people's lives. These good works that we're supposed to be doing, they touch people. They mean things to people. Now, there's a beautiful illustration about this in the book of Acts, chapter number 9, and verse number 36. Now, I want you to take your Bibles and go ahead and turn over there to Acts chapter 9 and verse number 36. Acts 9 and verse number 36. Now, this is going to explain, remember, these good deeds, they're to touch people's lives. And I guarantee you, every single one of us, if we could just think hard enough, we can think about something that somebody did for us, a good work that touched our lives, that really, really meant a lot to us inside. It meant something to us. Somebody thought about me, and they made this for me, or they did this for me, or it was some kind of a good deed that touched me. Well, Acts chapter 9 and verse number 36. Now there was at Joppa a certain disciple named Tabitha, which by interpretation is called Dorcas. This woman was full of, what's the next two words? Full of good works. That's right, in alms deeds, which she did. Now God makes a distinction between good works, which are public, and alms deeds, which are private. There's some things that we do, giving alms, that is just between us and God and somebody else. Sometimes it's just between us and God. And the person doesn't even know that it was even done to them. Just that something that only God sees. It's kind of the things that where the Bible talks about, don't let your right hand know what your left hand's doing. In other words, you just do these things and nobody knows about them but just you and God. Just you and God. But these good works that we're talking about, they're public. Everybody sees them. And this woman here, Lydia, she was full of good works and alms deeds which she did. And look at verse 36. And it came to pass in those days that she was sick, and she died. Boy, that's tragic. But when they had washed, they laid her in an upper chamber. And forasmuch as Lydda was nigh to Joppa, and the disciples had heard that Peter was there, they sent unto him two men, desiring him that he would not delay to come to them. Then Peter arose and went with them, and when he was come, they brought him into the upper chamber. Now look at the next part. And all the widows stood by him, weeping, and showing the coats and the garments which Dorcas made while she was with them. I'm telling you, that was the good works. That was the thing that she was doing that was touching these people's lives. When Simon, she had died, she was sick, and then she died. They put her in an upper chamber, then they went and washed themselves. It's what the Jews have to do. And then Simon Peter came, and when he came there, these widows were there, and they came to him, and they were weeping. They were weeping because Dorcas, this woman, had made such an impact upon their lives. And they were holding up the coats, and they were saying, look, she made this coat for me. She made this dress. And she made this skirt. I mean, Dorcas was the kind of woman in the church. I mean, the preacher would say, hey, we're going to go to Mount Salem in a month. So we need to put in a culotte order. Amen. She's the kind of woman that make all the culottes for all the teenage girls. Amen. So they could be go to camp. That's the kind of woman that she was. She did good works. Hear me? here's the point. These good works that we're all ordained to walk in, look at me now, they touch people's lives. They touch people's lives. They're a blessing to people. And probably every single one of us can think about something that somebody did that touched us. And it meant so much to us. Amen? And in return, it brought glory to God. And when God visits them on the conviction, if they're lost, it's going to be more simple for them to be saved. You know, when we started the radio station, we met all kinds of people in our area. I was holding a revival meeting for a friend of mine. His church is in Salem, West Virginia, Lighthouse Baptist Church. I was there early and I was working on my book table, and I noticed the doorknob wiggling, the front door, so I went and opened the door, and it was an older gentleman. He was scooped over like that. He walked with a funny homemade cane. And the only thing he said to me was, "I want to talk to the preacher." Kind of rough like that. "I want to talk to the preacher." Well, I said, "Well, he's in his office. If you'll just walk through the vestibule, turn right. His door is to the right. He's in his office right now." So I heard that old man hobble around, and he made the corner, made the turn, and then he looked in the office, and he said to the preacher, "I want to talk to Oliver Areza." And the preacher said, "You just passed him. He was in the vestibule." And I heard his feet shuffling around, and he came around to the vestibule, and he looked at me, and he says, "I heard you on the radio, and your voice, you don't look like your voice." Amen. I get told that a lot. Amen. "You don't look like your voice." Well, we've become good friends. He's probably 96 years old now. His health is failing. He's just getting so thin. But he's just a wonderful man. He gives to the radio station just so generously. Just such a blessing. And he's hard of hearing. So he has WVGV playing in his house 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I'm sure all the people that live around him, they have to listen to it too. He's got the radios turned up so loud. And I went to visit him one day, and we went to his little old house. Now, he's got enough money. He could live in a very fancy house if he wanted to. But he has a very simple trailer house that he lives in. And he's put an addition on the back of it. He has a little wood shop back there, and he makes these little wooden things. He's given my wife a little napkin holder and plate holder. And I was visiting one day, and I saw this real weird-looking foot cut out of this thin plywood, like the one. In the shape of a foot, but it was a weird foot. It was a long, narrow, and weird foot. And then over by the ball of the foot, just underneath the toes, there was a little piece of sandpaper, real coarse sandpaper, glued on that foot. And I picked it up off of this wood shop desk, and I said, "Brother Edge, what the world is this for?" He said, "You don't know what that's for?" Man, I thought he's going to get over me. Yeah. I said, "Well, I don't know." He said, "Son, that's a foot file." I said, "What?" He said, "It's a foot file." He said, "Once you get out of the shower," he said, "you take that thing and you just rub it on your heels and on the balls of your foot, you know, and on the sides of it, and man, it'll take all those rough spots off of your feet, and it'll make your feet nice and smooth and make you feel real good." And ain't no telling how many of those foot files Brother Ed just made. I mean, those of us that live in Doddridge County, we've got the smoothest feet in all of West Virginia. Amen. You know why? Brother Philip Edge, he buys the wood, he traces it out, a pattern, he cuts it out, sands it, puts that little piece of coarse sandpaper on there, and gives them away. You know what he's doing? He's touching people's lives. He's touching people's lives. You know, we just kind of think that just do this for me. Do this for me. Just do this for me. Do something for me. Do something for me. And God says, no. If you want to be happy, you do something for somebody else. You draw a picture. You write a note. You make a craft. You give it to somebody. Maybe your mom or your dad or your teacher. Amen. Or your preacher. Those good works, you know what they do? They touch people's lives. It's a wonderful thing. How many of you tonight, how many of you can say, "Brother Oliver, I can think of a time when somebody did a good deed to me, for me, and it meant a lot to me. Hold up your hand. You see there, look at that. Look at that, almost everybody here, if not everybody. Well, listen, somebody did it for us. What if we stopped doing it? You see what I'm saying? We got to do that. You see, we're just in a time right now where everybody just expects everybody to do something for us. But God says no. We are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. It's kind of like a proof that we've been saved. Don't you think that's what that verse means, preacher? Amen. Ordained of God. It's kind of like the proof. Amen. The proof. And you get some boys around a basketball hoop, and one of them says, I bet I can make 10 free throws without missing. And his buddy's throwing the ball and says, all right, here you go. Quit talking and shoot. Amen. Well, God says, now that you're saved, quit talking and do good works. He says, it's ordained of God that we should walk in them. You see, this grace that has saved us, that's what it produces. And those good works always bring glory to God. And it touches people's lives. And then lastly, the Bible says in the book of Hebrews chapter 10 and verse number 24, it will provoke others to do the same thing. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to what? Good works. And then it's amazing, verse 25, not forsaking the assemblies of ourselves together as a matter of some is, but exhorting one another and so much more as you see the day approaching. Now that word provoke unto love and to good works, it means to incite. Amen? In the context of the passage, it means to incite to good. Amen? It means to inspire them to do this. Amen? It means to provoke that we are to provoke unto love and to good works. A friend of mine's father was buried yesterday. I talked to him about 9:30 yesterday morning. And he made a reference. I must have told a story about my dad when I was preaching at his church. When my dad passed away at the viewing, there was just so many people there. And we had all these people coming to us. And they were telling us things that my dad did. And we didn't know anything about it. They were telling us stories about, I remember one guy, and he thanks him for my dad every time he sees me. He says, but Oliver, my dad got hurt at work. We literally didn't have anything to eat. He said, I just cannot tell you how many times did your dad come to our house and would bring us bags of groceries. We never knew that my dad did that. Never knew it. And then somebody else come and say, man, your dad is. And I was having a hard time. He did this. But your dad did this. Or your dad paid for this. Or your dad did this. You know what that does? That provokes me. It says to me, Oliver, you need to be like your dad. You need to be doing good works. You need to say that to me. Provoking the love and the good works. Every single one of us. For we are real. Both of us are real. How many of you are saved tonight? It's you. We are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God had before ordained that we should walk. Tonight, why don't you just ask God, Lord, what can I do? Who can I do a good deed for? What can I do to put a smile on somebody's face? What can I do that'll mean something? What can I do? What can I do? We're His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together, shall we, with our heads bowed and eyes closed. Everybody stand with us. I know I've already asked you this a couple of times already. How many of you have said with all of her, I'm saved and I know I'm saved? Hold your hand up as a testimony. If you're happy to be saved, won't you look at me for just a minute? If you're happy to be saved, why don't we give Jesus a wave tonight? Amen. We'll just give him a wave off you tonight. Amen. If there's anything worth waving about that's being saved, amen, let's bow our heads for prayer. And while our heads are bowed and eyes are closed, I wonder, would there be somebody here tonight who'd say, with all of the praise for me, I'm not even a Christian. I'm not even saved. Boy, I sure need to be saved. God's speaking to my heart. Would you pray for me? Anybody like that? Would you pray for me? I need to be saved. There's a young man right there that makes his hand. God bless you, sir. God bless you. God loves you. He wants you to be saved. He wants you to know for sure that you've been born again. He wants you to have a relationship with God. Now, while our heads are bowed and eyes are closed, I'd like to ask Pastor Ray, if you wouldn't mind standing in front of the Lord's circle here and there, facing the center aisle. Now, while our heads are bowed and eyes are closed, I'm going to ask this one precious young man that raised his hand, Richard, stand. I'm going to say, would you look at me for just a minute? You raise your hand. Look at me, please. God bless you, son.
Come on.
Did you raise your hand for salvation? You did. You've already been saved. You better watch out, son. I'll get you saved again. Amen. You better pay attention to church. All right. Now, here's what I want us to do. I'd like to, really, if you're able to kneel, I understand that everybody may not be able to. We certainly understand that you can just sit right down where you need to and pray. But if you're able to kneel, just that act of humility, it's just responding to God in humility. That's just what it is. It's helpful for us. But while our heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if the Lord has spoken to your heart and you need to be a part of these good works that glorify God, that touch people's lives, that provoke others unto love and the good works, won't you just come to this altar and ask God to help you? Maybe there's somebody that did a good work to you and maybe need a thank you tonight. I think God would be honored. I'm going to ask the Lord's blessing on the invitation that our pianist, the organist, will give us an invitation hymn. Then you come and pray. Do what you need to do for Jesus. Father, help us today. Bless the invitation time, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As she plays for us, God touched her heart. Won't you come this morning?